The RF 1015 having arrived, we'll call the House Tax Committee to order. We're a little bit short of a quorum at this point, but as soon as we have a quorum, we will jump in and officially start the meeting. Is Representative Mariani, are we on? Yeah, we are, okay. Is Representative Mariani here? Is Chair Nornes here? That's going to be a short meeting, guys. I guess we'll wait for, I think Chair Mariani's on his way. The third bill. So we have Mariani's bill, Nornes, David's for the agenda today.
Mr. Chairman, being at least one of the authors is here, we could proceed with the David's bill.
I guess we could. That might be the longer one. And so I think we want to, you know what, let's do that. I think we will start with the House File 3124. That would be my intention when one of the other authors is here. We will go there. Okay, Chair Mariani will be here in a little bit. I'd also like to introduce, we have a contingent of FFAers from District 28B. We have a large contingent from Chatfield. We have some Fillmore Central and Lanesboro. Is Lanesboro here? They're here to lobby on the dam, just so you know. So with that, I think we should welcome the FFAers from Fillmore County. Well, welcome to the Tax Committee. No, we shouldn't. Well, life belongs to those that show up, so why don't we go ahead? I will move House File 3124, so members can take out House File 3124. And then it'd be my intention, when we get another author here, we will just temporarily lay it over. Any amendments? No amendments. So we have House File 3124. We have the revenue notice. Doesn't tell us a whole lot. Okay, so with that, I'll start out, Mr. Michael, if you could, or is this Ms. Manzi or Ms. Dalton? We'll get one of you here. Ms. Dalton, if you could please describe the bill, and then we will. But before you do that, I think we'll temporarily lay it over. We're very fortunate to have Chair Mariani with us, so I will move House File 3560, members. So we have House File 3560. There is an amendment. Hello, Chair Mariani. Is your
Good morning?
Is that your amendment, the A1 amendment?
I believe it is.
Okay, I guess actually, members, we'll wait. Do we have a quorum? Not quite yet. We will have the bill presented to us as if the A1 amendment has been added to House File 3560. So with that being said,
I have an A1 amendment. Do you?
We will proceed, Chair Mariani, as if the bill is in the shape you would like. So if you could please present your bill, sir.
Mr. Chair, and members, thank you for hearing House File 3560. Last week, I had the privilege to introduce several bills in coordination with several communities, immigrant communities spanning different nations of origin, race, religion, and geography in our state. And quite frankly, Mr. Chair, members, what we're trying to do with this are twofold. One is to pursue some really good policy in terms of easing and greatly enhancing the ability of our immigrant communities in Minnesota to integrate fully and powerfully into our state. And then the second thing, quite frankly, we're trying to do is really lift up what I believe is a core Minnesota value of being very welcoming and inclusive and building a powerful state with one another, including our immigrant communities.
Chair Mariani, if I could please, yes. I'll officially call the meeting of the House Tax Committee to order, as we do have a quorum. Representative Simonson moves the minutes of March 30th, 2016. Any addition or corrections, seeing or hearing none? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion prevails. Thank you, Representative Simonson. I will now move House File 3560. I will now move the H3560A1 amendment. Any discussion on the amendment? It is an author's amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion prevails. We now have the bill in the shape the author would like. Chair Mariani.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Very efficient. The many of you know that Minnesota, while our immigrant communities are not huge compared to what you see across the nation, our immigrant our trends in our state are very huge. You know, we tripled in the last decade our immigrant presence in Minnesota, while the nation doubled their presence. So there's some really powerful trends that are happening in our state. This bill, really in a nutshell, is about speeding up the process by which immigrants, new Americans here, can move forward in terms of their naturalization. And what that means lots of things. One of the things that it means, quite frankly, is to be able to much more fully interact economically in our state. So think about, you know, being able to access credit, being able to buy a home, start a business, et cetera. In the private marketplace, what you have are a lot of questions, are appropriate questions, which is, you know, immigrant Davids, are you planning to stay around, you know, for the next 5, 10, 20 years, you know, during the lifespan of the loan? So that's just a small example of some of the benefits in terms of naturalization that flow back to us as a state in Minnesota. The bill basically, it's pretty simple. It provides a tax credit up to, I believe we've got a cap, we have a cap of up to $700 for the cost for naturalization. That's going to be a one-time process. Folks are going to be constantly, you know, cycling through naturalization. You know, one way that we could do this work, frankly, is that we would, if we were the certifying body, if you will, you know, the state would say, instead of using a tax credit mechanism, you know, let's just waive the fees, you know, let's provide some kind of, you know, direct subsidy. It's the federal government, however, that does that work. So that's not for us to do. So this is one way in which we could be present with applicants that uses the tools that we have available for us to ease the economic burden for them to go through the naturalization process. And frankly, hopefully induces them to do that quicker. And the quicker they do that, my argument is that the better we're going to be off, better off we're going to be in terms of fully integrated peoples into our society, able to interact economically with us.
Oh, wonderful.
Thank you. And I do have someone here to testify on the bill as well, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Chair Mariani, I have listed Mr. John Keller, yes, and a Henry Jimenez.
Yes. And
you don't want to see how this is spelled.
You didn't do too bad, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Let's go. Who would you like first?
I'll ask Mr. Keller to come.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Keller, please state your name and who you represent for the record, please, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is John Keller. I'm the Executive Director of the Immigrant Law Center of Minnesota. We're the state's largest provider of free legal services to low-income immigrants and refugees. We have services, offices in four different parts of the state, one in Worthington, one in Moorhead, and two in the metro area.
Welcome to the committee, sir.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here and testify in favor of HF 3560. I also brought together with myself one of our interns who is affected and would benefit from this policy, Ms. Zamzam Ahmed. If there's time, we would be very delighted to have her share briefly about her story.
Ma'am, please join us at the table here, or them at the table, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Keller.
Some background on who we're talking about and the process for naturalizing and why this is a good idea. In Minnesota today and over the last several years, there's been a running average about 80,000 legal permanent residents eligible to file for citizenship. That means they have at least 5 years of being permanent residents, having their green cards. That average has stayed about the same for several years. Every year, there's about 12 to 13,000 additional permanent residents who either immigrate to the U.S. or who move into that status. They might have been a refugee or an asylee and become permanent residents. And then every year, about 10 to 12,000 people naturalize already. There are folks who are moving through that process. What we have is this large group of people who are not able to naturalize, and one of the top reasons for that is cost. The Minnesota Chamber of Commerce, the State Demographer's Office, has talked about the importance, the vital importance of not only attracting immigrants and refugees to the state because of our shifting demographics, but also of keeping them here and of helping to make the most of their potential in Minnesota. This is one of the ways that we can do that. For naturalization, you need to have the basic background of 5 years of permanent residency, unless you got your permanent residency through a citizen, then it's 3 years. You have to be a person of good moral character. You have to be current with your taxes and any child support obligations. And you have to be able to speak, read, and write English to pass the test, as well as pass the civics and government questions. I brought along some of the 100 questions in case any of you are curious about taking some of those tests. It's a serious test, and people take it very seriously. The responsibilities in becoming a citizen: you give up allegiance to any other nationality or sovereignty. You swear allegiance to the United States. You swear to support and defend the Constitution and the laws of the United States. And you promise to serve this country when required. The benefits of becoming a citizen: you will forever be a U.S. citizen. You cannot have it taken away from you. You are given, under the Constitution, equal rights in almost everything except running for president. You cannot be deported. Again, permanency. This is the sinking down roots of people who opt to stay and remain and become U.S. citizens and Minnesotans. You have more opportunities for employment. Many federal jobs, the post office, Department of Agriculture, NASA, for example, require you to be U.S. citizens. For students, you have more opportunities to get scholarships. And you'll hear from Samsam the importance to her. Legally, you're also able to reunite family members faster. What may take 6 years to bring over a spouse or a minor child can be sped up to a year and a half. Your family gets reunified in a faster period of time. You can travel. For many immigrants who come from war-torn countries, refugees and asylees, our legal advice is you should not travel home until you're a U.S. citizen, for obvious reasons. For many of our clients, the ability to go home after 5, 10, or more years is one of the main incentives to become a citizen. And finally, you can vote and run for office. The economic, as Representative Mariani referenced, are also clear. National reports indicate that salaries increase between 8 and 11% by naturalizing. Workforce participation rates for naturalized citizens are significantly higher than they are for other non-citizens, about 70% workforce participation, which is actually higher than the U.S.-born rate of workforce participation. Home ownership rates increase when you become a citizen. About 66% of the foreign-born who own homes are naturalized U.S. citizens, and rates of poverty fall. Only 6% of naturalized citizens are below the poverty level, which is actually lower than U.S.-born citizens. And 16% of people who are not naturalized citizens or non-citizens are below poverty. Education is another important aspect where you see results by naturalizing. 22% of naturalized citizens have a four-year college degree versus 10% of non-naturalized residents. In Minnesota, our numbers are even better than the national average. Over 33% of foreign-born persons who are naturalized U.S. citizens in Minnesota had a bachelor's degree or higher. 22% was the national average. When you add associate's degree and some college credits, naturalized U.S. citizens are at 58% have either a bachelor's degree, an associate's degree, or some college credit, and the native-born population is at 61%. So again, you're seeing permanency and the ability to catch up and in some places exceed. The benefits of this bill, of HF 3560, the cost to file for citizenship is prohibitive for people who cannot get a federal fee waiver. So one of the things the bill spells out is people who are already getting means-tested benefits, the federal government will waive your fee of $680. For people slightly above that or who are not getting federal means-tested benefits, this is a significant delay. We have clients who everything is ready to go to file their cases, but they cannot come up with the $680. So this will be a way in which people can move forward. Obviously, the lower income folks between 150 and 200% of federal poverty line, levels are who we're talking about. This is the working poor, usually people who have one or two part-time jobs, or students. We cannot get those fees waived by the federal government. The significant increase in the citizenship application fees is the reason we're here today. Over 200% increase in 2007, and from 1998, over 600% increase in the cost in filing for citizenship. Finally, we believe, and we've seen in other parts of the country, government, state and local government getting involved in trying to incent, for the reasons I've discussed, citizenship. We believe that this tax credit will incent for, informal borrowing, borrowing between family members, potentially between employers, faith groups, to front the fees to somebody that they want to support. Ultimately with the tax credit, the ability to have those fees reimbursed. With that, I'll turn it over to Ms. Ahmed, who can tell you why this is important to her.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Keller. Just to get a little lay of the land here, is there anyone else who wishes to testify on behalf of this bill other than Henry Jimenez? Is he here?
I am.
Okay. So we'll go to the lady here and then to Mr. Jimenez. Is there anyone else who wishes to testify on behalf of the bill? Anyone that has concerns about the bill? Now, Chair Mariani, you're not real familiar with the Tax Committee, I don't think, but
I'm not, Mr. Chairman.
If nobody's against you, we kind of, you know, I don't know. I read the book Shut Up and Sell. When you got the sale, you know what I'm saying. Okay, so with that, of course, we do want to hear full and complete testimony. But with that being said, for Mr. Keller, are there any questions for Mr. Keller? Okay, Representative Torkelson, and then Hack Barth, and then Barrett.
Thank you, Mr.
Torkelson,
Chair.
Representative Torkelson.
Mr. Keller, I maybe you covered this, maybe you didn't, but I'm aware of cases where folks that are trying to get their citizenship end up going to lawyers for help and are charged what seems to me to be exorbitant fees in some cases. Can you enlighten me on that a little bit?
Mr. Keller?
Mr. Chair, Representative Torkelson, I can't speak on behalf of all lawyers in my practice area. Immigrant Law Center is a legal aid organization, so we do not charge fees. Our clients have to be income eligible. We ask for a donation, but it's not required to get service from us. The thing I can say is most immigration attorneys, it's a relatively small bar for citizenship. Private attorneys can charge anywhere from, I would say on the low end, maybe $1,500 for legal services up to $5,000. What we always encourage people who we can't help or who make more than our income guidelines is to shop around like you would for any other service. The complexity of some cases, I can tell you that we have had clients whose application for citizenship has taken multiple tries and multiple years because of things in their background, anywhere from inability to prove your birth certificate because you left a country that no longer has civil records, to run-ins with the law. So complexity can range from a four-month case to multiple years, and that obviously will affect the cost.
Chair,
I don't know if I answered your question completely, but
thank you. Sure. Vice Chair Barrett.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Kelleher, can you describe maybe how long it takes to become a U.S. citizen? The understanding, or at least my understanding, is it takes quite a bit of time with many delays. Is that true or not true? And I'm just wondering how that would affect the the need or want to have a credit to expedite the process for people who can't afford to pay.
Mr. Keller. Mr.
Chair, Representative Barrett. It's a great question. When people come into our office and we review their eligibility, we usually tell people it's an average of about 6 months from filing to interview. You know, our job as lawyers advising in this area is if somebody presents and they, you know, maybe they had a DWI within the last 2 or 3 years, we'll advise them not to apply and to accumulate more time of good moral character. So if people present with clean or relatively clean cases, it's reasonable to expect the process to begin and end within about 6 months. The lead up to being able to file, I think the average amount of time somebody's been a permanent resident before they file is about 8 years.
Vice Chair Barrett.
Sure, just a quick follow-up, Mr. Chair. So the filing fee happens at the beginning of that process?
That's correct. You cannot, Mr. Chair, Representative Barrett, you cannot file without the $680 filing fee.
Sounds good. Thank
you. Vice Chair Barrett.
Just one quick follow-up to maybe staff, I think, would be able to answer the question. There's probably many precedents in which we're paying a state credit to a federal or a federal fee. I can't think of any, but probably in the education area, I would imagine, with education expenses we have. Is there maybe, Mr. Michael might want to answer that, is there a precedent for this type of state credit for a fee paid to the federal government?
Mr. Michael?
Mr. Chairman, Representative Barrett, I cannot think of any direct analogy to this with regard to a tax credit. It may be that in the education direct spending grant area that there are things that students get reimbursed for that are federal charges, but I don't know.
Ms. Mansi?
Mr. Chair, Representative Barrett, it's not a tax credit, but just in the income tax in general, if a person is operating a business and has to pay some sort of federal fee as part of their cost of doing business, then they're allowed to claim that as a deduction on against their business, you know, income at both the federal level and the state level. So that flows through the income tax and is somewhat, it's a federal fee.
Vice Chair Barrett. Is there anyone from the department that wished to testify on this bill at all? Okay, thank you, Mr. Cummings. Chair Carlson.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I was just curious about the history of this fee. When I looked over the legislation prior to the meeting, I quite frankly was kind of surprised that it cost $700. And is that, I guess for any of the potential witnesses, the history of citizenship fees, have they always been that expensive? And what I was reacting to is if a couple immigrated, then we're talking $1,400, which the bill covers. But I'm just interested in the history, if the federal government has been jacking up those fees or just what has been happening in recent years.
Mr. Keller, a very brief history. I'd like to start like at 1900.
That's when my grandfather immigrated 1900, but he joined the Navy. And that's how he got his citizenship way back then. I don't know if that's still the way you can do it today.
Mr. Keller, to the Carlson question.
Mr. Chair, Representative Carlson, the fees have gone up astronomically. As I mentioned in my initial testimony, since 1998, it's a 610% increase in citizenship application fees. The fee in 2007, which was the last time this was raised, at that time represented a 200% increase. And what we saw before the fee became effective was a dramatic increase. I don't remember the percentage. I want to say it's about 25% increase of applications, of people trying to get the application in, and our office handled many of those cases. So what we saw the next cycle, sort of once that period of pre-increase ended, was a decrease in applications of around 30%, and a lot of experts believe that's attributable to the fee. Your question about couples, it is very common in our office to represent the common scenario is a refugee father a husband and wife who both immigrated at the same time. They're on the exact same schedule to apply for citizenship, but they choose one or the other. They save their money. And then one of them applies. This happened with a client of mine a few years ago who also shared his testimony.
Okay, Mr. Keller, we're going to go to Ms. Manzi here in research.
Mr. Chair and Representative Carlson, there was a similar proposal before the House in 2006, and looking at the revenue estimate from that time, in 2006, the application fee was $330, and then there was an additional $70 fee for the biometric fingerprinting, and that fee, looking at the revenue estimate we have here today, is now $595, and then $85 for the fingerprint fee. The federal government has also increased the income level at which people are eligible for the waiver from 100% of the federal poverty guideline to 150%. So that has happened, but the fingerprint fee is not subject to waiver, so that you have to pay even if you're eligible for the waiver.
Yeah. Chair Carlson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was just interested in what the history was. I had made the assumption that one of the reasons that you're here was the escalation in the cost and what that would mean for a family. But I found, Mr. Chairman, the comment then that it sometimes with these high fees forces some families to choose which one is going to be able to become a citizenship and the or a citizen and the other has to wait. So interesting outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Carlson. Chair Anderson S.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll just be brief. Just thinking about what Representative Torkelson said, are there any protections to make sure that the individuals that would be eligible for the tax credit, that they're not going to be preyed upon by attorneys that are going to say, hey, we'll get you $700, and oh, by the way, our attorney fees are going to be $5,000, and access that, or other organizations that maybe don't request money up front but want it later on? I mean, is there some protections on that in this legislation at all?
Mr. Keller?
The protections, Mr. Chair, Representative Anderson, the protections when we come across people who are taking advantage of immigrants or vulnerable clients usually lie either with the county attorney's office or the lawyer's board or the attorney general's office. And we've seen this happen in other circumstances, and those would be the resources at our disposal at this point.
Mr. Chair.
Chair Mariani.
And Mr. Chair, to the issue of the tax credit, so great question, also because it speaks to the qualified citizenship expenses, and of course we define that in line 2.10, which means the filing fees, fingerprint fees, you know, as determined by the USCIS. And so that needs to be tightened up in terms of making sure we're not opening up a spigot to, you know, bad behavior, you know, or exploitative behavior. That certainly would be my intent, that, you know, all we're doing is covering those qualified expenses as identified by the federal government.
Chair Anderson S. Representative Wills.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I just had a question. I don't know if it would be for the testifiers or for staff. Looking at the language of the bill, the timing of when the credit would be given to the individual on line 1.8, it says that it's for expenses paid for a qualified citizen applicant, and then on the back page, line 2.4 and 2.5, qualified citizenship applicant means individual or individual spouse or dependent of the individual. It just doesn't seem clear to me if the individual would be qualified once the application has been completed and they have become a citizen, or if it's during the process. Maybe if staff or the testifiers could enlighten us on the timing. Thank you.
We're going to line 1.8 and 2.4. To the Wills question.
Mr. Chair, Representative Wills. Well, I see that we have a little bit of a typo there. So on 1.9, it should probably say qualified citizenship applicant, since that's what's being defined on 2.4 to 2.5. So that would be a technical correction that the committee might want to make. But I think the person would be the applicant, you know, before they had become a citizen at the time they were paying the filing fees. So, for example, we're now in the month of March, still just for today. If someone were to pay the filing fee today and, you know, go in and become a citizen, then they would be eligible to claim this credit on the tax return that they would file next year against their taxes. So that's how the timing would work.
Chair Mariani, if we amended that, would that be favorable to on 1.9 delete the word citizen and insert citizenship?
I believe, based on Ms. Fransky's explanation, that it would be, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Representative Wills moves that on line 1.9, we delete citizen and insert citizenship. Is that correct, Representative Wills, to that point?
Yes, Mr. Chair. I would move that amendment and then additionally just add the comment that I'm a little concerned if the credit is given before the individual has actually become a citizen, and I don't know if that could be something we could address at some point.
Representative Wills, when they're filing taxes, they're not a citizen, wouldn't they need to get the credit? Or maybe Ms. Manzi, they would be getting this possibly before they're actually a citizen.
Right.
They're still paying. Right? For Mr. Michael? You're paying taxes. You're here legally. Mr. Michael?
Mr. Chairman, Representative Wills, what triggers the credit is paying the qualifying expenses. The credit is not contingent upon successfully being granted citizenship. And so oftentimes drafts like this will explicitly say paid during the taxable year. This does not say that, but it certainly would be implied. And so, to take an example, someone pays in December, that, you know, toward the end of the taxable year, but they don't, the citizenship isn't determined until the next year. You would want to grant them the credit in the taxable year they actually paid, not, you know, whatever happens later. And some may actually not get citizenship, but they would still qualify for the credit because you had to pay the filing fees to actually, you know, have that determined.
Representative Wells.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And that's my concern. I wouldn't want to discourage anyone from not completing the process if they were able to get the credit before they completed and became a citizen. And certainly, I'm sure most individuals who enter the process have full intention to complete the process and become a citizen, otherwise they wouldn't be doing it. But I would just recommend that the author consider clarifying that it's after the individual has become a citizen. And I can understand and appreciate that we want to help them with the expenses and that it would be more helpful to receive it sooner. But again, I just wouldn't want to discourage anyone from completing the process by not having it at the end.
Representative Wills, maybe you and Chair Mariani could visit about that issue. But for now, members, any further discussion to the motion to, on line 1.9, delete the word citizen, insert citizenship? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion prevails. Thank you very much for that. Okay, item next, any members? Okay, let's go to more testimony. If you could please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
My name is Zamzam Ahmed, and I am testifying for, the bill.
Okay, I'm sorry, can you please spell your name?
Z-A-M-Z-A-M. Last name A-H-M-E-D.
A-H-M-E-D?
Yep.
Thank you, Ms. Ahmed. Ms. Ahmed, to the bill.
Thank you. I am a student in St. Catherine University. I am a junior. I came to the United States in 2004. I was 10 years old at the time, and I came as a refugee. And I've been eligible to apply for citizenship in 2009, after 5 years you're eligible to apply. But I haven't been able to due to the costs. I live with my aunt and have been living with my aunt for a while. And we live in a household of 9 people. And I was at the time, at 18 years old, I was able to apply for citizenship without having my parent there. And I haven't been able to. I go to St. Catherine University, which is a private institute, and so my tuition would vary from $30,000 to $40,000 a year, which required me to work a lot more, and I was in eligible to receive public benefits. And so if I were to apply for citizenship, I wouldn't get the fee waiver because I'm not on public benefits. Reasons why I haven't become a citizen yet would be mainly because I was not in the custody of my mother at the time I was eligible to become a citizen. And when I turned 18, I was not able to pay for it. Not having citizenship has closed a lot of doors for me. For instance, going to a private institute, it's really helpful to receive scholarships. And many of the scholarships that I came across, I would meet all of the qualifications except for the fact that I am not a citizen. And there's some loans I would try to apply for, but I would need a co-signer for some of them because I'm not a citizen. I study political science and international relations at St. Catherine, so I do hope to run for office or join the government at some point after I graduate. And some jobs that I do, like I would like to have, require me to have citizenship. And when you are given a green card, a permanent residence card, it expires at a certain time, and after it expires, I don't know what happens. I think you do get deported at some point. And my green card expires in 2 years. And so if this bill does pass, it would really open a lot of doors for me. And not just me, I know a lot of students who are going to school and are not on public benefits, so they're not able to apply for citizenship because school is costly and other things through life are very costly. And if this bill were to pass, it would help a lot of students like myself and others who are not students and are not on public benefits but still can't really afford to pay $700 for citizenship. And knowing that I will, if the bill does pass, knowing that I am able to get that money back, I know if I do borrow it from a bank or from an individual, I will be able to pay it back, having that guarantee that this money will come back to me through tax season. And that is my story. Thank you.
Thank you for coming before the committee, Ms. Ahmed. Any questions for the witness? Mm-hmm. If you could all stick around, we'll allow members to ask questions of everybody once we've heard from Mr. Jimenez. If you could please provide your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is Henry Jimenez, the Executive Director of the Minnesota Council on Latino Affairs. Our council supports House File 3560 because it's a step forward to assisting thousands of eligible Minnesota residents move closer to achieving their American dream by becoming a U.S. citizen. While there are many great reasons why eligible residents should become citizens, such as the right to vote, benefit from U.S. tax laws, become eligible for federal loans and scholarships to further their education, many low-income Latinos face the burden of paying close to $700 for a single person's application fee, and much more when dealing with attorney fees to undertake the application process of a family. 71% of Latinos' working age population is employed in comparison to 76% of the white population. However, on average, Latinos fare far worse when they get their paychecks. The median income of a Latino-headed household is $18,000 less per year than that of the overall state median household income. That puts one in every four Latino residents living in poverty, more than double the poverty rate for all Minnesotans. These are some of the reasons why we believe the citizenship credit will have a significant positive impact on the Latino and other immigrant emerging communities, and we urge the committee to move this bill forward. We also received emails from some of our Latino constituency on this bill, and I would like to read just a quick statement from Sarah Lopez from Minneapolis. She wrote to us saying, "Becoming an American citizen is a life-changing, often emotional experience for many immigrants currently living in the United States. Unfortunately, the high cost of the application process is a barrier preventing many families from becoming naturalized citizens. The cost of a one-person application is $680. When a family of four decides to submit an application, often using services of an immigration lawyer, the price tag is prohibitive, ranging in the thousands of dollars. New Americans deserve financial relief, as the ability to afford an immigration process should not determine the right to vote, run for office, as well as the freedom to pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness of thousands of eligible residents aligned in the state of Minnesota. She personally was able to become a U.S. citizen last year after 5 years of becoming eligible for the process. The reason was she was able to obtain a job from a community organizer to working at the city of Minneapolis. So it took her to get to that more financial stable position to be able to afford to go through this process. That's all I have. Thank you,
sir. Ms. Ahmed, what is your major in school? At school?
Political science and international relations.
Those are actually your majors. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Okay. Questions from members for any of the witnesses? If not, any, you want to wrap it up? Chair Mariani? And thank you for your testimony, folks.
Well, Mr. Chair, members, thank you for your careful attention, and I hope that this proposal receives your equal attention as you put together a bill here. I don't think, generally, I don't think that we should approach the use of the tax credit, quite frankly, in a very liberal way. I think you're absolutely appropriate to apply a pretty strict lens by which you would engage in using tax credits. I think in this case, with this community, that can meet that strict lens. And I think it does because of the incredible benefits that flow back to our state in terms of the enhanced economic and social experience and interactions that these communities will have to our states that lift up their families at the same time continues to lift up our prosperity. So I think it's a pretty good deal. I think we should absolutely make sure that the language is tight. I'll certainly work with Representative Wills in that regard. And I look forward to this ongoing conversation. Thank you, Mr. Chair, for this hearing.
Thank you, Chair Mariani. I will renew my motion that House File 3560 as amended be laid over possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We didn't really need to vote, but it sure made me feel good. Okay. With that, I will move. Nornes? Is Chairman Nornes here?
He was.
Okay, Chair Nornes, if you could please join us. I will move House File 2574. And again, we will not be voting on it, but this bill would be laid over if we decide to do that. So I'll move House File 2574. Members, I don't see any amendments. You should have a revenue note and a House research summary.
There's a handout. You got a page that can help with that?
Yes, do we have a page? The page could help hand out.
He'll take care of it.
Welcome to the Tax Committee, Chair Nornes. If you could, I have moved House Bill 2574, so it is before the Tax Committee. If you could please tell us what you're doing.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. This is one of two bills that I brought to the legislature this year regarding a hunt club in my district, and this would apply to others besides, but it came specifically from a constituent. It simplifies the bookkeeping requirements regarding the sales tax treatment of clay targets purchased by a hunting club or a shooting range. And to be more detailed on the requirements or the need for this bill, Les Bench is here to testify from the Viking Valley Hunt Club.
Okay, welcome to the committee, sir. If you could please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and committee. My name is Les Bench. We own and operate a membership hunting club in western Minnesota.
Excuse me, it was, last name is?
Bench,
Bench
B-E-N-S-C-H.
Like Johnny? Like Johnny Bench?
Nope.
Oh.
He's my illegitimate brother.
Okay, so, not the spelling I was referring
to. Yes, German pronunciation and spelling, B-E-N-S-C-H.
Oh, B-E-N-S-C-H, for the record. Okay. Now, before we get going, does the department wish to testify on this bill? Okay, anyone else that wish to testify on behalf of or with concerns thereof? Okay, please proceed, sir.
There was some confusion back in 2002 when this requirement was put on us. Jack Manson was the with the Department of Revenue at the time. I'm not sure if Jack is in the audience or not. But essentially, the confusion lied when they wanted us to pay sales tax on the targets when they were received at the club. Now, we received targets in 18-wheelers, 68,000 pounds at a whack, and we said this is a supply item for a resale business, and we would like the tax charge as the point of resale. There is no revenue impact on this. We're not arguing the tax position on this. We're saying that if you look at that second page of the handout, the gyrations that we'd have to go through is separate the targets out from the hunting or from the shooting, and it became a very confusing issue with our customers, with our bookkeeping, with our cash register, and all we were asking is a simplification of this. There is no tax impact. We plan and we will continue to pay the full retail tax on this product.
Thank you, Mr. Bench. Any questions for Mr. Bench or the author? Anyone else wish to testify? Okay, I will. Oh, are you a resource here, Mr. Cummings, or? If you could please join us.
Get the tax.
Please state your name and who you represent for the record, please, sir.
Mr. Chair, my name is Paul Cummings, and I'm the tax policy manager at the Minnesota Department of Revenue. It was referenced, Mr. Chair, that there was some confusion, and I just wanted to state that there is not. The Department of
Revenue. You're not confused, is what you're testifying to?
The Department of Revenue is not confused, Mr. Chair.
Okay.
These items are being treated consistently with other types of products, much like batting cages or driving ranges. If they are consumed within the price, then they would be taxable.
Mr. Cummings, we tax driving ranges?
For the price to use the driving range, yes.
Okay, I'll discuss with Chair Nornes an amendment later. I think that's just wrong. It's so many levels. Okay, Chair Nornes, do you want to wrap her up here?
I'd like to ask if there are any questions from your committee members about my testifier.
Any questions? The Chair Hart.
I don't know if I should go offline and try to figure out what the hell you're doing here, but because I don't understand it, but why are we doing this? Mr. Chairman,
Ms. Dalton, could you tell us why we're doing this?
Mr. Chair, Representative Earhart, right now, a shooting club to get an exemption on their clay targets that are used in the shooting at their facility have to list the shooting fee separately and the clay target separately, and then they charge sales tax on those two separate items. That is the only way that they can buy the clay target exempt from sale as a sale for resale. What this would do is just say it's exempt as an input to a taxable service. They can just list the shooting fee as one thing and then charge the sales tax. So they don't have to keep the two things separate.
This is Chair Hart.
Tax on a business service, is that what we're saying, on input?
Ms. Dalton.
Mr. Chair, Representative Earhart, this is a taxable service, and so, yeah, it would be essentially exempting it as an input to a taxable service.
Yeah, okay.
Chair Earhart?
Okay.
Any other questions for Mr. Bench or the author? With that, I'll renew my motion. The House filed 2574 be laid over for possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. Thank you, Chair Nornes. Thank you, Mr. Bench. Okay, item last. I will move House File 3124. Okay, members, you should have the revenue notice and the summary. Okay, so, Ms. Dalton, what am I doing?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, what this bill does is it makes an effort to expand the duty to collect and remit sales tax to additional businesses, primarily remote sellers. It does this through four different mechanisms, which I'll talk about when I do the section by section. The language is based on model legislation developed by NCSL in response to the fact that the U.S. Congress has essentially not taken any action on the Main Street Tax Fairness Act or any of the similar bills to kind of address the issue of sales tax collection by remote sellers. So this bill, I'm going to talk about this on a section-by-section basis. The real crux of the bill is going to be the discussion on the marketplace providers and the referrers. But we'll start with Section 1 just defines what it takes to have a physical presence here in the state, and it adds a storage facility employing a state resident who works out of an office in their home, making clear that that's also an agent. But the big thing is it says if you use a marketplace provider, referrer, or other third party that has a physical presence in this state, then you are also subject. You're basically saying those are agents of yours in the state, and you have to collect the sales tax. Section 2 expands the definition of retailers not maintaining a place of business on state. It's basically very similar to current law. Probably the biggest things it adds is if you're using information or software that's stored or distributed in the state, if you're doing data analytics on customers in the state, so you're really taking advantage of what it means to be taking advantage of the market in the state. Section 3 is affiliate, defining what affiliate entities are for purposes of determining whether you have a sales tax, a duty to collect sales tax in this state. We actually expanded this once a couple of years ago by adding what was called the solicitor nexus, you know, when we had the click-through websites were considered an affiliate. This also basically adds definitions like if the two affiliates are selling the same or similar product using the same or similar name, or if the remote seller is having his customers pick up purchases at the facilities of an affiliate that are actually located in the state. It also specifically expands the affiliate nexus to include any time that the ownership arrangements are set up specifically to avoid collecting the sales tax. Sections 4 through 6 are really the crux of the matter. They define what a marketplace provider is and what a referrer is. A marketplace provider is an entity who lists a seller's goods and services normally on, and we'll say, website. It can be a physical site as well, but for all practical purposes, we're talking about electronic marketplaces such as Amazon or eBay. If the marketplace provider lists the seller's goods and services and completes the transaction on behalf of the seller, the marketplace provider is also required to collect and remit the tax on behalf of the seller, and this only applies to sellers that meet some minimal thresholds of at least $10,000 in annual sales into the state. So that's sections 4 and 5. Section 6 defines what a referrer is. It's similar to a marketplace provider, but instead of completing the transaction on behalf of the customer, they send the customer to the seller's website to complete the transaction. They do not have a duty to collect the tax, but they do have they would be required to register with the state and report contact information on all the sellers who are doing business through their site, along with any available information on volume and types of sales that those sellers are making through their sites. They are not required, as a matter of fact, they're prohibited from providing information on individual purchasers, so this won't violate that data privacy. They also must notify the seller that they are providing this information to the state. If they do not register, if they do not provide this information, then they are liable for the sales tax on the purchases made through their site. And Section 7 is a severability clause. What this essentially is doing is it's expanding our definition of remote sellers who have to collect sales tax. This is not, this kind of set of facts has not actually been litigated yet. So this is kind of saying if anything is found unconstitutional by the courts, that doesn't invalidate the rest of the bill.
Okay, thank you. And members, the reason I've been working on this issue for quite a few years, it was brought to my attention by a very nice furniture store in Fountain, Minnesota, Drury's Furniture. And what they were running into was people had come in from all over the place, and they would look at Thomasville, they would look at various brands of furniture, and they would kind of in their mind get, you know, exactly how they wanted to do it. And then they call up Thomasville in North Carolina and say, hey, send me $40,000 worth of furniture, and there'd be no sales tax paid. So it was a great disadvantage to the bricks and mortar folks that are actually paying property taxes for the schools, the cities, and the counties. Now, Ms. Dalton, if we had that situation where we went to Drury's Furniture in Fountain, Minnesota, you looked at a bunch of stuff, you called up or you went online to Thomasville, North Carolina, ordered your furniture, they're not paying a sales tax, are they supposed to pay a use tax?
Mr. Chair, the customer would be subject to the use tax in this state.
How are we doing on collecting that, Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, we actually aren't collecting very much on use tax from individual customers. We do collect use tax from businesses who are making out-of-state purchases. Often we collect those on audit.
On audit. That's a good time to collect things, of course. Okay, so with that, let's get into some testimony. Did you have something for Ms. Dalton, Representative Petersburg? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just so I understand, when we're dealing with internet sales, it sounds like there's a $10,000 threshold in the previous year. So does, just so I'm kind of clear on it, if I find something out of state online, this year I may not pay sales tax, but next year I might? Is that, if it goes over that $10,000 threshold?
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, Representative, basically the firm that you are buying from would have to start collecting the sales tax if they go over that 10,000 threshold.
There's some Petersburg. Okay. Let's get a lay of the land here. We have, I have on my list here, and let's just make sure we know what we're doing here, a Newstead, Hiltner, Cadoon, Larson. Is there anyone that wishes to testify in support of the chairman's major piece of legislation here? Is there anyone that wishes to testify with concerns?
I got some questions.
Is there any, does the department wish to testify? Does the department support this? You should. Does, maybe I'll bring up, because I would like to know if the department, I will talk offline to see if the department has a position on this fine piece of legislation. Okay, with that, let's start with, so I have, let's see, I have Newstead, Hiltner, Cadoon, Larson. So, Mr. Newstead, please state your name and who represents for the record, please, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Bruce Newstead. I'm the staff president of the Minnesota Retailers Association. We're a group that represents about 1,200 stores across the state of Minnesota. Some of those would be like Drury's, mom-and-pop type stores. Some would be what we call regional retailers, where you might have a few stores or in a couple different states, and some of those are national brands. Those stores all impact about 788,000 jobs across the state, and they have three things in common. They love their customers, they love their employees, and they love their communities. First, I just want to lead off by saying thank you, Mr. Chair. You talked about it, but this committee has been very good in supporting sales tax fairness in the past. The 2013 bill, the affiliate nexus bill, did a long took a long ways and did a lot from a Minnesota perspective relative to trying to correct some of the inequities in how sales taxes are collected and by whom and when. So we appreciate that my organization has a long-standing tradition of supporting those types of efforts. One area of criticism, it's not for the committee or for the state of Minnesota, but we wish we weren't here talking about this issue. We wish the federal government would act and do its job in the sales tax fairness area. There's the Marketplace Fairness Act and the Sales Tax, the Remote Transactions Parity Act. both of which are sitting at the federal level and really are the best places to deal with these. Absent that, we end up having conversations like this at the state level to deal with things on more of a patchwork type basis. So thank you, though, for the committee's interest in discussing this particular issue. I just want to provide just maybe a little high-level example to frame it up for the committee of how this sort of works. So pretend you're going to buy a fishing pole, and for whatever reason you choose not to go to your brick-and-mortar store to buy your fish pole, and you search online. And you come up with a store online that you decide you want to buy your fish pole from. Now, some stores are going to sell you or offer you their own fish pole that they sell. They inventory it, they take care of the transaction, they'll deliver it to you or ship it to you. Some stores also will provide an extended marketplace. So that's a marketplace affiliated with their website, affiliated with their store, but it's actually selling third-party products. So the bill does a lot to define what that looks like. So I think the onus of the bill is an attempt to say, if you operate a website and you are a marketplace seller, that you would collect the state sales tax in that case. So you may choose to go to a website, you may choose the fish pole, it might be a third party's fish pole, the transaction still is initiated or touched by the retailer online, it just uses their marketplace. So it's a term, an electronic marketplace is a term you'll hear fairly regularly. So that's the type of transaction that is the large impetus behind this bill that the chair has put forward. Brick and mortar retailers traditionally will tell you that they feel that transaction, even with the third party marketplace, should be taxed in the interest of sales tax fairness. I suspect that's what juries would tell you. Brick and mortar retailers that also have an online presence that also might have a marketplace, some of those are actually already collecting that tax. They're collecting the Minnesota sales tax. There are retailers that will have an online marketplace, their own products and third parties, but they'll interpret the law as they don't have to collect that sales tax. So in those cases, those retailers would tell you that they're in an intense competitive environment, and until the federal law changes, they shouldn't have to collect those sales taxes. So I think those are the three types of perspectives you're going to hear on this bill. I will say from a Minnesota Retailer Association perspective, these conversations are great conversations. We want to continue to have them. We want to discuss what makes sense and what doesn't make sense. So for that, Mr. Chair, we thank you for the opportunity to be here today.
Thank you, Mr. Newstead. I think we'll go through all the testimony, then we'll open up for members' questions. Mr. Mike Hiltner, please state your name, like I guess I just did, but and who you represent, please, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Mike Hiltner. I'm Senior Director of Government Affairs for Best Buy and also a member of the Minnesota Retail Association Board of Directors. Hopefully everybody knows Best Buy, but if you don't, we're a leading consumer electronics retailer and related services. In Minnesota, we have 35 stores, a distribution center, and of course our corporate headquarters in Richfield, and all together represent about 7,000 employees. And for the privilege of being a retailer in Minnesota, we collect the sales tax, as you all know. About $47 million in sales tax comes through Best Buy stores or our website to the state of Minnesota. And in addition, we pay nearly $52 million in our own property taxes and fees for the various operations we have in the state. Coincidentally, this year, 2016, represents the 50th anniversary of Best Buy, or our 50th birthday. We started with just one store in 1966 in St. Paul called The Sound of Music. Maybe some people remember that store. And retailing was very different back in 1966. It was brick and mortar. Your competition was across the street or across town. You had to be competitive anywhere. And today, fast forward to 2016, and you have brick and mortar retailers like you see in your main streets and your districts. You have online-only retailers that we shop. You have brick and mortar and what we call omni-channel retailers like a Best Buy and other big retailers where we have stores, we have websites, we have digital stores, mobile phones. And we have a whole generation of consumers now that actually prefer shopping on this than ever walking into a brick and mortar store. So the challenge we have is that our sales tax code largely reflects a world that looks more like 1966 than 2016, given all these various ways that consumers can shop and how retailers can establish their business model. So as a result, we still have this inherent competitive disadvantage against in some cases, online-only retailers that have a physical nexus in the state and operate marketplaces. And this bill, we think, goes a long way to correcting that and making sure there is a level playing field for any business, any retailer who chooses to compete in Minnesota's marketplace. And we think that's fundamental to fairness. So I would just wrap up by saying we strongly support this bill and appreciate this committee's consideration. This bill is consistent with the policy the state has taken with respect to leveling the playing field. Minnesota has been a longtime member of the Streamlined Sales Tax Initiative for many, many years. In 2013, this committee and the legislature passed, and the governor signed a bill to address some of the affiliate business models out there. And so we think this is consistent with that approach. We all hope Congress addresses this issue, but in the meantime, there's certainly things states can do. Sales tax begins and ends as a state issue. We think this is well within the authority Minnesota has to, at least in the meantime, regulate these types of business models. And we'll ensure we have efficient collection of sales taxes, that everybody who participates is treated the same and plays by the same rules. And most importantly, provides fairness for everybody, every retailer here, big or small. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Hildren. Now, your headquarters are in Richfield.
They are.
That's the high school is the Spartans? Mighty yeah. Spartans?
Yep.
Yeah, Richfield Spartans. Okay. Ms. Dalton,
wearing the green
does this
Spartans.
Have any effect on the streamlined sales Spartans tax issue, the compact
yeah, that's
business?
The
so in Michigan, Michigan.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, this leaves Streamlined intact. I mean, our belonging to Streamlined intact. So this won't affect the voluntary taxes that we're already collecting under Streamlined, if that's the question.
Okay, that is the question. Thank you. The next gentleman, if you could please state your name, who you represent for the record.
Mr. Chair, committee members, my name is Robert Stewart. I'm a senior director at Best Buy in the tax group, and I'm here to help answer any technical questions that may come up from
so
committee
you're a
members.
Resource.
I'm a resource.
You're a resource. Okay. Thanks for being here, sir. Ms. Larson, or no, I'm sorry, Cadoon. Ms. Cadoon from the chamber, if you would please present your testimony. And then if you could hang around, because if we do have member questions, we want you available. Please state your name, who you represent for the record, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Beth Cadoon. I represent the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce. I'm
welcome
here
to the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Here to support this bill, and thank you for bringing it forward. The Minnesota Chamber has long had a longstanding policy of we want to make sure we have an even playing field for our sales and use tax collections between our online retailers as well as the brick and mortar stores. We've been strong support of that, obviously support of the affiliate nexus bill that passed a few years ago as being a good first step in that effort, and supported congressional action as well, which as you've heard, they failed to do. And so we do believe this bill is a good move to help with that effort. I would just also like to say we would hope to work and continue to work with the chair as this bill moves forward, because we do believe there's maybe a little bit of language that still needs to be kind of fine-tuned in this as well.
And Ms. Cadoon, I would appreciate if we'd also include the department in those talks, because I want to make sure we're all together. Okay, now Ms. Larson, I believe. And then we'll go to questions from members, and then we'll go to lunch. Ms. Larson, you are the only one staying between us and lunch.
I will be very brief, Mr.
I'm sorry.
Chair.
Please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Mr. Chair, Jill Larson with the Minnesota Business Partnership. I just wanted to come up here and go on the record supporting the chair's bill.
Well, that's good. Ooh.
No, I do have a couple more comments. I want to echo the comments.
That was fine. That was fine.
I'm done. We do support the policy goals of the bill. We have supported this policy in the past. We supported the Affiliate Nexus Bill in 2013. We see this as just another part of the process to continue leveling the playing field and ensuring that all retailers are playing by the same rules and helping out our hometown retailers. So thanks for the time.
Well, thank you, Ms. Larson. Questions for members? Chair Earhart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What has changed that we can go ahead with this now? Was that streamlined sales tax holding us up for a while, or what? This is a shift in our thinking here.
Ms. Dalton?
Or that we're able to do it now because the feds aren't doing it, or what?
Mr. Chair, Representative Earhart, I do think a lot of what's driving this legislation in this state and other states has to do with the fact that, you know, people had been waiting for Congress to take action.
Yes.
Quill essentially invited Congress to take action many, many, many years ago. and it's clearly not happening. There's been a recent court case where a minority report by one of the judges came out pretty strongly indicating that they would almost like to see a state send the Supreme Court a new case. So I think that's also what's driving it. One of the things that you've had handed out to you is legislative action in other states. Three states have actually enacted legislation. Alabama and Louisiana have expanded their nexus based on dollar amounts of remote sales. Those laws are actually going into effect. Alabama's is in effect. It passed in December. It's imposed a duty to collect on remote sellers with more than $250,000 in sales annually. Louisiana's is based on $50,000. And one of our neighboring states, the state of South Dakota, actually signed into law in the end of March, and it will be effective May 1, 2016, a bill that may be best described as, we want to challenge the ruling in Quill. And it pretty much imposes the duty to collect on all remote sellers and above a certain threshold, and then provides for some expedited court processes to move the case to the Supreme Court as quickly as possible.
Chair Earhart.
Mr. Chairman, do we have any revenue note or what the expectations are of this thing? I don't think I saw it.
I think on the revenue estimate,
yeah,
it's unknown, but if you go down into revenue analysis, detailed potential revenue gains, if all out-of-state businesses are required to remit tax on sales to Minnesota customers, it's estimated to exceed $200 million per year. And that's on the revenue notice dated March 30th. Chair Earhart?
No, that's all. I didn't find a revenue, I guess.
Okay, it should be in your pack. If you don't have one, we'll get it to you here.
Okay.
Please state your name and who you represent for the record, please, sir.
Mr. Chair, my name is Paul Cummings, and I'm the Tax Policy Manager at the Minnesota Department of Revenue.
Welcome to the committee, sir.
Mr. Chair, as it relates to this legislation, I know that it was loosely modeled after some NCSL legislation. And first of all, I just really wanted to thank Ms. Dalton and some of the other staff who's really taken quite a bit of time to try and craft this piece of legislation. The Department of Revenue and others have reached out to various businesses. I know that we had met with Best Buy earlier this year, and they really did quite a good job talking about the impact about how the current laws and the Supreme Court decision have created a situation in which similarly situated taxpayers are having two different tax impacts. So ensuring that similarly situated taxpayers, that there is fairness there is something that we're always sort of, that's a value of ours and that we want to, we continue to support. As it relates to the legislation that is in front of us, we are continuing to meet with advocates. We're continuing to talk about this legislation internally, and we're looking forward to continuing the discussion with you, Mr. Chair, as this moves forward. But fairness and consistency in our tax code has always been something that that we have seen as a value, and that we also understand the impact that this has on Minnesota businesses.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings. Any questions for Mr. Cummings? Chair Earhart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Will we have to hire any more folks at your department to monitor this if this law passes?
Mr. Cummings?
Apparently there's some that are escaping now without being found out. Will this create a bigger situation?
Mr. Cummings?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, in terms of what would the fiscal impact be on the Department of Revenue in terms of administration, we have not done a type of fiscal note on this, but what we would assume is that if this were to pass, that there would be, that many of the businesses would likely voluntarily comply and pay with the tax laws. There may be, we don't know what type of impact this may have on litigation in the future or what this would mean for attorneys, but we wanted to, I think we'd like to do the analysis as it relates to how this tax law would impact the department.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings. Chair Earhart.
Mr. Chairman, this is a question for you, I think. I know at one time when Rochester raised, found some sales tax money, there was a bill that you wanted to share that with the Preston and some of the other cities. If we manage to get this into action, we get $200 million, do we have to share this with Preston again?
Chair Hurd, I do have an amendment. And just for the record, that was the Greg Davids good neighbor policy, like a good neighbor Greg Davids is there. But it did not include Preston.
Oh,
it included cities within 25-mile radius of the center of Rochester.
Okay.
And so it was Chatfield and Spring Valley and the district I'm so fortunate to represent, and then it was like Byron and Cass, and it was a great idea. Chair Earhart, you have the floor?
No.
Chair Carlson.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I was just going to footnote your comment about the local business, that the furniture store that came in. I remember that testimony quite well. But probably everybody on the committee, I've heard from businesses out my way, western, northwestern suburbs, and often it's the small businesses that I hear from that express very similar stories to what you shared with the furniture store. You know, they come in and they shop, and even some of the larger ones, but the small business ones, businesses are the ones I mainly have heard from, where they shop and then they go out and buy it online, whatever it is, if it's an electronic product or perhaps furniture or something like that. So I think it's a very important issue for many Minnesota businesses, both large and small. We heard here today from some of the larger businesses and, you know, the larger chambers and what have you, but and the retail folks, but I just want to emphasize that it does impact on those small businesses, as you shared.
Thank you, Chair Carlson. And, you know, some in the past have argued that, well, Chair David, you're carrying a huge tax increase. I don't look at it that way at all, because if we realize that when a purchase is made, a use tax is supposed to be paid. So that should be being paid, but it's pretty much unenforceable. I mean, the department does a great job, of course, but it's tough. It's tough. You buy something from out of state, and you're supposed to pay use tax to the state of Minnesota, and you don't pay it. This really cleans things up a lot, and I think it makes it easier for the retailers. I think it makes it easier for the department. And so I do not in any way consider this to be a tax increase, because if it was, there's only one bill that I would carry like that, and that's carrying the governor's bill. So I'm, you know, that's – so for that argument, I would respectfully disagree. That it's because we're just collecting what we're supposed to be collecting in a bit of a different, a more direct way. Real quick here, Ms. Dalton, what year is the Quill decision?
You what?
92.
18? Mr. Chair, it's 1992.
Well, that was before Al Gore invented the internet.
Yes.
Well, that was after.
Okay. It was, but the Quilt decision was really a mail order decision. No one has taken a electronic marketplace or an internet.
I kind of expanded it just a bit.
To court yet.
Yes. Chair Anderson S.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I don't know if this, maybe Ms. Dalton, if you can help me out. So say I am a, I have a Etsy product that I sell out of my home. Small town operator. And I'll just give you an example of experience I just had 6 months ago. So Etsy operator, and they advertise birthday card invitations. And you can buy the whole birthday card invitation. It gets emailed to me as a file, a PDF file. And so there's no way for that individual to know what state I'm from or whatever. So is this saying that this would expand this to them? Because this is an Etsy operation that advertises on Pinterest, Facebook, all the different social media sites. So would that now be considered they have to collect the sales tax? Or can you give me a little better description on that?
Mr. Chair, Representative, it's not quite clear because I don't have enough information, First off, they would have to have $10,000 worth of sales into the state. They would have to be able to tell that you're a sale in the state. And the way they would do that is, the way we do cytosine for those types of sales is based on your credit card information. So we do, you know, we couldn't tell if you have a Minnesota credit card and you took delivery in South Dakota. The default under Streamlined would be that if we don't have an actual physical address of delivery, it will go based on your billing address. So they do have a way of figuring out where you are. Again, as I said, it would take $10,000 of annual sales in the state before somebody would be subject to the tax. And then it would depend on how they are getting you as a customer. There has to be a commission or fee involved in the place that is referring you to their website. So yes, ITSE is probably taking a commission. I assume that, and I have to admit, I do remarkably little buying on the internet, so I'm unfortunately not as versed in how it all works as I would like to be. But yes, to the extent that ITSE has a presence in this state and is taking a commission, you would be subject to the sales tax. If they are a marketplace provider in this state, so they do have a physical presence in the state, they would be required to collect this, and they were doing the transaction for you, they would be required to collect the tax and remit the tax for you. So, I mean, the person selling on Etsy. If they are, Etsy is sending you to a different website, that provider may or may not be subject to collecting the sales tax, but ITSE itself would have to provide information about that seller to the state, and the state could make some determination on whether that company is subject to the sales tax and have that discussion with that company.
Well, let me ask you this, and then I have a question for our resource. So if I... what if my billing address, though, is maybe I'm from Florida originally and I kept my home bake and that's my home address that I list there, but I actually live in Minnesota. How would that work and how would they track something like that?
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, Representative, if you actually go to our cytosine law, which I was about to pull up and take a look at, there's a laundry list of the steps we go through to determine the source or the destination of a sale, because we are a destination sales tax state. And we always start with where the delivery takes place. But if we don't have that, then there is a laundry list of what we go through to source that. You're right. If somebody kept their billing address on their credit card at a Florida resident, and they were here in Minnesota, there's no way we can track that. So it's we do the best we can. But we have to assume that if we can't find any other way, then that billing address becomes where we source the sale to.
Ms. Dalton, why do you list your laundry? I've always wondered that.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, you still have the floor, but I do have a real quick question. Ms. Dalton, in the case that Chair Anderson S. is describing, if we did nothing and she made that purchase, would she owe a use tax? Which there's an exclusion. She'd be buying a lot of birthday cards. I think, what's the exclusion, $750? Ms. Dalton?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, the exclusion was set up to be roughly $50 of sales tax owed in a year. So if you made, it's roughly $750, $770 of sales. If you make more than...
how big your family is for birthday cards.
Right. If you make more than $770 of purchases subject to use tax in a year, then you are supposed to be remitting that use tax, and the information regarding that actually shows up on the income tax instructions, but it does not show up on our income tax form.
Thank you. So it'd be total purchases. It wouldn't be just her birthday card.
Mr. Chair, that's correct. It's total annual purchases.
Mm-hmm. Why is it in the rules for the description and not on the forms?
Mr. Chair, there have been a number of bills introduced to put it on the forms, and my understanding is the department has opposed having it put on the income tax form because it would kick the income tax form over to another page.
Oh, okay. Chair Anderson S., you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Mr. Cummings, how is the department going to track this? I'm guessing this is going to probably require more staff time. Do you have a fiscal cost estimate on this? I didn't see a fiscal note here at all. And maybe is this something that needs to come to state government finance if it has an impact on the Department of Revenue's budget?
Mr. Cummings?
Mr. Chair, Representative Anderson, we haven't done the type of analysis relates to the fiscal or the administrative costs in the department. One of the things that we appreciated about this hearing is that we wanted to learn more about the bill and whether, you know, the point of imposition was the retailer or was it the marketplace that would be collecting the tax, you know, for the seller. Would it be you or would it be Etsy? You know, we're just trying to learn how this bill is sort of constructed and thought through. And I think that will be helpful in us trying to figure out what is the type of impact administratively on the department.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Chair Anderson. Okay, thank you. The gentleman, the resource gentleman from Best Buy, please state your name and who represents the record, please.
Mr. Chair, committee members, my name is Robert Stewart. Once again, I'm at Best Buy in the tax group, and I just wanted to clarify something about the Etsy example and to make sure that everyone's aware that when we're talking about marketplace operators being required to collect sales tax in Minnesota on their sales, that's if the marketplace operator has a physical presence in the state. Now, I'm not sure if Etsy does have a physical presence in the state. That would only, you know, Etsy would only be required to collect in your example if they did. So it's not an expansion of Nexus with regard to marketplace operators. It's marketplace operators that have a presence in the state and they may be collecting on their own sales and they're just not collecting on marketplace sales. So, thank you.
Okay. Questions for Mr. Stewart? I'm glad there's people that do this stuff and it's not me. Okay, thank you. Any other questions for any of the testifiers? Mr. McDonald, Representative McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A question for, probably Ms. Dalton or Mr. Cummings regarding digital files, page 3, sections 2, 3.8. Correct me if I'm wrong, in the state of Minnesota currently, if a file is transferred from the seller to the buyer, a digital file, is that taxable, that particular digital file? If there's nothing tangible transferred between buyer and seller, is that item currently taxed?
Ms. Dalton, would his photos be taxed?
Mr. Chair, Representative, it depends on what's included, what that file consists of. We tax a number of digital goods in this state. We tax downloaded music. We tax e-books. We tax e-cards. We tax, I'm doing this from my, you know, we
games.
Tax electronic online games. There's a bunch of things that meet the definition of taxable digital goods. I would again have to look at the laundry list of everything that's included in it.
Representative McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Ms. Dalton. Well, I do have a bill last year that I introduced that repealed that digital download tax, so I hope that's still in the omnibus bill. I think it is. But in this particular legislation, this particular bill, Mr. Chairman, it does note that any digital file that is transferred from the out-of-state seller to a buyer in-state, that would be taxable. Is that correct?
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, Representative, no. The language that you are referencing actually discusses what makes a retailer who is a remote seller potentially liable for collecting our tax. It isn't that they have to pay tax on these digital transfers, but if they're doing... If they are doing these digital transfers, particularly with a marketplace provider, that may make them liable for the tax in this state.
Representative McDonald.
And then lastly, thank you, Ms. Dalton. I believe I understand that. How about a service? I read in this that software, digital files, information software in the state. Let's say a company has a contract with a software company for maintenance, and it's $100 a month for maintenance and we'll just call it a maintenance software agreement with a company. Is that particular item would be taxed? Is that what would include in line 3.8 software in the state?
Ms. Dalton.
Like updates to software. I have, in my Photoshop, we have Photoshop and our software maintenance and updates.
Ms. Dalton.
Mr. Chair, basically this would have to do with if you are using things, software from a company that exists in this state, and you are getting information from that company, that might trigger the fact that you're getting, that you have nexus for collecting sales tax. It doesn't make that transaction between you and that software company necessarily taxable. That would be under our existing law on how we tax canned software versus custom software. We tax canned software, we don't tax custom software.
Representative McDonald?
I think that's what you're getting at.
I think so. I think I understand that. I'm getting in the way of lunch, Mr. Chair, and I'll be finished here.
That's fine. I have some reserve.
I have a donut here.
Representative McDonald.
Because, for example, a maintenance and update to a software company, if I have troubles with my software, my admin, my accounts, receivables, and such that I run a business, and I have to call for some backup, and they, here's your problem with your computer. So we tax his problem solving for a software glitch in my computer?
Ms. Dalton.
Mr. Chair, Representative, we're getting way off the actual subject of this bill. I mean, you're asking, are these various transactions related to software maintenance, are they taxable or not taxable? That's not what this bill addresses. This bill actually addresses if you are using software located in this state to solicit sales in this state, that can be setting up your nexus. But it's not dealing with whether those transactions or the maintenance of that software is taxable or not taxable. Right. That's not what determines whether you have nexus or have a duty to collect.
President McDonald?
That's good. Yeah, I don't want to get off the topic of the bill. I'm just reading it.
We never do that.
No. So maybe I can talk to you offline and read that section that I...
And
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I would actually agree with the department. The model legislation that was essentially dropped into this bill, it does not necessarily work really well with our existing language. A lot of the things that are covered by that model legislation are already taxable in this state or are already subject to the duty to collect in this state. This bill mirrored some language that had been offered by the Senate tax chair, and they just picked it up wholesale from the NCSL language. I think if we're really going to move forward, we need to make sure that this language actually works with our existing law a little better, and so there would probably have to be some rewrites to some of this language.
And the author is committed to work with the department and House Research to make sure this thing works if it gets that far. Okay, other questions from members? And I don't worry about my lunch hour. I got Jimmy John's. They're here just like right now. Okay, freaky fast. Okay, so any other questions for any of the testifiers or Mr. Cummings or for research? Okay, I will renew my motion that House File 3124 be laid for possible inclusion in an omnibus tax bill. With that, is there anything else for the good of the order, members? If not, good government all the time. We are adjourned.